9¾.
Best to do it at a run if you're nervous.
Mischief managed.
I need to find my son. We need to.
I've never fought alone, and I never will.
Grab your cloak, take out your wand, and dust off your broomstick. You are going to Hogwarts. Well, since we can't actually transport you to the Wizarding World, we're going to bring the magic of Harry Potter and the Cursed Child to you at home. My name is James Howard, and I play Draco Malfoy in the London production of Harry Potter and the Cursed Child, the 8th story in the Harry Potter series. Harry Potter and the Cursed Child picks up where the Deathly Hallows ends, 19 years after the Battle of Hogwarts, with Harry, Ginny, Ron, and Hermione arriving at King's Cross Station with their children, who are now enrolled at Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. We can't perform on stage at the moment, but we are incredibly excited to have reunited some of the cast members of Cursed Child London virtually for a table read of the first 3 scenes of Harry Potter and the Cursed Child. And although we can't bring you the full spellbinding theatricality, we hope you enjoy hearing the words from some of our cast members. And do stick around, because we've got lots more in our magical lineup.
Theatre, to me, is extraordinary because the actors are interacting with a different audience every night, and the audience is an integral part of the whole experience, and so it's truly alive, and that's what's so exciting about it.
You're there, it's immersive. The sound is surrounding you, the lights are there. You're almost part of the show. You're very involved in the storytelling. And I think the theatre experience is second to none for that. And you get to see the characters that you know grown up, and there's no opportunity for you to be able to do that other than in the play. You get to see the adult versions of those characters and what kind of adults they've become and how the past has informed their choices as grown-ups.
It's brilliant. Like, you've got these amazing Hogwarts school uniforms, and obviously playing a Malfoy, you've got the incredibly important white blonde hair, and it makes you feel very much like you're a part of the world. It's amazing.
Hi, I'm Jamie Ballard, and I play Harry Potter.
Hi, I'm Michelle Gale, and I play Hermione Granger.
Hello, I'm Thomas Aldridge, and I play Ron Weasley.
Hello, I'm Susie Trailing, and I play Ginny Potter.
Hello, I'm Dominic Short, and I play Albus Potter.
Hello, I'm Jonathan Case, and I play Scorpius Malfoy.
Hi, I'm Rochelle Diedrichs, and I play Rose Granger Weasley.
Hello, I'm Ryan Mackay, and I play James Potter.
Hi, I'm Rosie Hillel, and I play Trolley Witch.
Hi, I'm Des Kennedy, I'm the International Associate Director, and I'm reading the stage directions.
Hi, I'm Taylor Bett Brockett, and I play Lily Potter.
Act 1, Scene 1, King's Cross. A busy, crowded station full of people trying to go somewhere. Amongst the hustle and bustle, 2 large cages rattle on top of 2 laden trolleys. They're being pushed by 2 boys, James Potter and Albus Potter. Their mother, Ginny, follows after. A 37-year-old man, Harry, has his daughter, Lily, on his shoulders.
Dad, he keeps saying it.
James, give it a rest.
I only said that he might be in Slytherin, and he might, so... fine.
You'll write to me, won't you?
Every day, if you want us to.
No, not every day. James says people only get letters from home about once a month. I don't want to...
We wrote to your brother 3 times a week last year.
What? James?
Yes. You may not want to believe everything he tells you about Hogwarts. He likes a laugh, your brother.
Can we go now, please?
All you have to do is walk straight at the wall between platforms 9 and 10.
I'm so excited.
Don't stop. Don't be scared, you'll crash right into it. That's very important. Best to do it at a run if you're nervous.
I'm ready.
Harry and Lily put their hands on Albus's trolley. Ginny joins James's trolley, and together the family run hard into the barrier. Act 1, Scene 2, Platform 9 and 3 quarters, which is covered in thick white steam pouring from the Hogwarts Express, and which is also busy. But instead of people in sharp suits going about their day, it's now wizards and witches in robes, mostly trying to work out how to say goodbye to their beloved progeny.
This is it.
Wow.
Platform 9 and 3 quarters.
Where are they? Late again. Why are they always late?
Harry points out Ron, Hermione, and their daughter Rose. Lily runs hard up to them.
Uncle Ron! Uncle Ron!
Ah, if it isn't my favourite Potter!
Have you got my trick?
Now, are you aware of the Weasleys, Wizard Weezy's certified no-stealing breath?
Mom, Dad's doing that lame thing again.
You say lame, he says glorious. I say somewhere in between.
Hang on. Now, let me just munch this air. Now, it's simply a matter of, excuse me if I smell slightly of garlic.
You smell of porridge.
Bing, bang, boing, young lady. Get ready to not being able to smell at all.
Where's my nose? You are silly.
Everyone's staring at us.
Yes, it's because of me. I am extremely famous. My nose experiments are legendary.
They're certainly something.
Parked all right, then.
I did. Hermione didn't believe I could pass a muggle driving test, did you? She thought I'd have to confund the examiner.
I thought nothing of the kind. I have complete faith in you.
And I have complete faith that he did confund the examiner.
Dad, do you think... What if I am? What if I'm putting Slytherin?
And what would be wrong with that?
Slytherin's the house of the snake, of dark magic. It's not a house of brave wizards.
Albus Severus, you were named after two headmasters of Hogwarts. One of them was a Slytherin, and he was probably the bravest man I ever knew.
Just say.
If it matters that much to you, then the Sorting Hat will take your feelings into account.
Really?
It did for me. Hogwarts will be the making of you, Albus. I promise you, there's nothing to be frightened of there.
Apart from the Thestrals.
Watch out for the Thestrals!
I thought you said they were invisible.
Listen to your professors. Don't listen to James. And remember, to enjoy yourself. Now, you don't want this train to leave without you. You should leap on.
I'm going to chase the train out.
Lily, come straight back.
Rose, remember to send Neville our love.
Mum, I can't give a professor love.
Rose exits for the train, and then Albus turns and hugs Ginny and Harry one last time before following her.
Okay then. Bye.
He climbs on board.
They're going to be okay, right?
Hogwarts is a big place.
Big, wonderful, full of food. I'd give anything to be going back.
That's strange, Al, being worried he'll be sorted into Slytherin.
Oof, that's nothing. Rose is worried whether she'll beat the Quidditch scoring record in the first or second year, and how early she'll take her OWLs.
I have no idea where she gets her ambition from.
And how would you really feel, Harry, if he is?
Well, you know, Jim, we always thought there was a chance you could be sorted into Slytherin.
What?
Yeah, honest. Fred and George read a book.
What?
Here we go now. People are looking, you know.
People always look when you three are together and apart. People always look at you, Harry. He'll be all right, won't he?
Of course he will.
Act 1, Scene 3, The Hogwarts Express. Albus and Rose walk along the carriage of a train. The trolley witch approaches, pushing her trolley.
Anything from the trolley, dears? Pumpkin pasty, chocolate frog, cauldron cake.
Al, we need to concentrate.
Concentrate on what?
On who we choose to be friends with. My mum and dad met your dad on their first Hogwarts Express, you know?
So we need to choose now who we want to be friends with for life. Well, that's quite scary.
On the contrary, it's exciting! I'm a Granger Weasley, you're a Potter. Everyone will want to be friends with us. We've got the pick of anyone we want.
So, how do we decide which compartment to go in?
We rate them all, and then we make a decision.
Albus opens a compartment door to look in at a lonely blonde kid, Scorpius, in an otherwise empty compartment.
Hi. Is this compartment...
Oh, it's free. It's just me.
Great. So we might just come in for a bit, if that's okay.
Oh, yes, that's okay. Hi.
Albus. Al. My name's Albus.
Hi, Scorpius. I'm Scorpius. You're Albus, I'm Scorpius, and you must be...
Rose.
Hi, Rose. Would you like some of my fizzing whizbees?
I've just had breakfast, thanks.
Well, I've also got some Choco Choc, Pepper Imps, and some Jelly Slugs. Mum's idea, she says, sweets, they always help you make friends. stupid idea, probably.
I'll have one. Mum doesn't let me have sweets. Which one would you start with?
Oh, easy. I've always regarded the Pepper Imp as the king of the confectionery bag. They are peppermint sweets that make you smoke at the ears.
Brilliant. Then that's what I'll... Oh, Rose, will you please stop hitting me?
I'm not hitting you.
You are hitting me, and it hurts.
She's hitting you because of me.
What?
Listen, I know who you are, so it's probably only fair you know who I am.
What do you mean, you know who I am?
Well, you're Albus Potter. She's Rose Granger Weasley, and I am Scorpius Malfoy. My parents are Astoria and Draco Malfoy. Our parents, they didn't get on.
That's putting it mildly. Your mum and dad are Death Eaters.
Well, her dad was, but mum wasn't. I know what the rumour is, and it's a lie.
What is the rumour?
Well, the rumour is that my parents couldn't have children. That my father and my grandfather were so desperate for a powerful heir to prevent the end of the Malfoy line that they used a time turner to send my mother back and...
Send her back where?
The rumour is that he's Voldemort's son, Albus. It's probably rubbish. I mean, look, you've got a nose.
Yes, and it's just like my father's... I got his nose, his hair, and his name. Not that that's a great thing either. I mean, father-son issues. I've got them. But no, on the whole, I'd rather be a Malfoy than, you know, the son of the Dark Lord.
Yes, well, we probably should sit somewhere else. Come on, Albus.
Oh, no. I'm okay. You go on.
Albus, I won't wait.
And I wouldn't expect you to, but I'm staying here.
Fine!
Rose exits.
Thank you.
No, I didn't stay for you. I stayed for your sweets.
Oh, no, she's quite fierce.
Yes. Sorry.
No. I like it. Do you prefer Albus or Al?
Albus.
Thank you for staying for my sweets, Albus.
Wow.
What a joy to be able to come together and bring that to you again. And we can't wait to bring the entire story back to the Palace Theatre London just as soon as we can. Now, a huge part of the show for both the cast and the audience is how we look as our characters. Wardrobe, hair, and makeup can make us instantly recognizable as some of the major characters that we all love, like Harry Potter with his lightning scar and glasses, or Draco Malfoy with his long platinum blonde hair. Wow, do I miss that hair. The team at Cursed Child London make a huge effort every single day to make every performance as perfect as possible. Now, we're going to take some time to answer some questions submitted by Sky VIP users. So I'd like to start with, if you had a magical power, what would it be?
I would like to fly. That would be pretty cool. I don't know if you can point your wand at yourself and say Wingardium Leviosa, but I could have a go at that if necessary.
I think I'd like to be able to hypnotise people, fiddle twizzly eyes, and maybe I'll sing a little song and then get people to do my bidding.
Quite a dark power you want to perform there.
I'm a Slytherin, what can I say?
Rochelle, let's go to you.
I know this is like a really boring one, but I'd really love Scourgeify. Like, I am known for just dropping my things on the floor like every other day. So if I could just go like, and it all be gone, that would be amazing.
Mine's would be invisibility, whether it be like the cloak or my actual skin's invisible. I don't know. Just endless amount of pranks you can play on folk.
I'd go for that too, invisibility, because you can be so nosy with invisibility.
Exactly.
That's the thing. I wanted to say invisibility, but then I thought you'd all think that I was a bit of a creep. So I was trying to think of something else. But as two people have said it already, yeah, invisibility.
Yeah. I echo Susie. I'd like flight. But the older I get, the more I get scared of heights. So I'd sort of, you know, take off. And then I'd get to a height and then realise where I was and absolutely, yeah.
The amount of times Harry falls off his broomstick as well, like in the books, it's...
Yeah.
Yeah. be careful, mate. I worry about you.
Thanks, bud.
A question for Jamie, who's our wonderful Harry Potter. And it's, what was it like to step into a character that was already well-established and well-known?
It was terrifying. Really, really quite daunting. Knowing how well-known, well-loved a character he is, and the responsibility of hopefully delivering to the many, many Harry Potter fans around the world, Harry that they knew and loved. So it was absolutely terrifying. But on the back of that, there's obviously a lot of literature to do homework. It's not like if you play Hamlet, you have the play to read, and that's it. And you can interpret it how you want and bring things to it. And if you, as long as you can justify it, then that's fine. With Harry, there is obviously a lot more literature that you can delve into, which is great. But it's also reassuring, but also, again, daunting to know that not just Harry, but all these characters in the books that are so well loved. Speaking to people after the show, they have taken solace in these characters in moments of in difficult times. And so as long as we can find the truth in the moment with all these wonderful people you're going to be talking with today, with Des, that took the pressure off a bit.
And Tom, Ron is a hugely loved character. How did it feel when you were cast, and did you feel daunted at all by becoming Ron?
Yeah, absolutely terrified. I kind of echo with a lot of what Jamie said there. It's so daunting taking on a role that is so loved by so many people. There's an awful lot of pressure there, but on the same side, you've also got this kind of overwhelming support of people who already love that character. So you kind of feel as though you're kind of lifted up by that a little bit and guided and helped, and you already have this amazing support of people who adore this character already, which is daunting and lovely in equal measure, really.
It feels like people might have come to the play originally with real preconceptions about the characters, based on what they knew from the books. And that's one of the really enjoyable things about playing this brand new play, 19 years later, as you said, Tom, about finding different aspects to the characters and how they've changed, how they've matured, particularly for the parents of Scorpius and Albus and Rose. Susie, how did you feel taking on Ginny? And did you read the stories to kind of find as much information about Ginny from the past?
Yeah, I mean, I echo what Jamie and Tom have said. It's such a privilege to be able to step into the shoes of somebody who people know and is well loved. But this is literally a new chapter for them. But yes, I did. I'd already read the books. I love the books. But it was, you know, as an actor, it was a real treat to go, who is this person? Well, I can go back and find out an awful lot about them. And, you know, Ginny is, people remember certain parts of the whole story, certain books that somebody may feature more in or certain plot points. But, you know, it's extraordinary when you're reading the stories again from a specific person's point of view, just the tiny little details, like, you know, people crop up. The first time you see Ginny when she's at platform 9 3/4 with her mum, and Harry is there, and that makes an impact on her. So yeah, I mean, I did read the books. I'd read the books anyway, but to be able to go back and read them again, and then even occasionally just to read them, to pick up a book. I know quite a few cast members have done that, have picked up a specific book during the playing of the show. I mean, just to be able to dip back into that and find something else and go, oh yeah, completely forgotten about that. It's not going to necessarily make a difference to the scene, but it will make a difference to what I know about the relationships between all of these characters. And that's amazing. I mean, that's really rare, doing a play, to have that much material to support you.
And Rochelle, John and Dom, how did it feel to be kind of almost like creating these new characters from scratch? I mean, we hear a little bit about them from the end of the books, but was that a particularly daunting thing for you?
It was exciting because for me, the first book I ever read when I was like 6 years old was Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, like cover to cover. And I remember going to my mum and being like, Voldemort didn't have a nose, this man, it was really like just blurting the story at her. And for me, it just kind of like, I took that excitement of it to be like, I get to go to Hogwarts finally, like as Hermione's daughter. So that was something that was like really exciting for me. And I kind of just tried to take as much of that and put it into how we got to play every night. So that was, for me, that was the best bit.
I think it's mad because a lot of the cast literally grew up with the books. So like, it is your first memories of the like the first time you're reading a book that has a whole world in it. So it's so mad to be literally playing a character within that world. So that's just been beyond exciting the whole time. I've never gotten bored of that. But also, it's been amazing playing Scorpius because obviously we know Draco so well, and we know, you know, he's a famous character, Draco Malfoy. People who don't even consider themselves fans of the Harry Potter universe still know of Draco. They know what he looks like. They know that he's antagonistic to some degree. He's complicated. And to be able to play a character who on paper subverts his dad's personality by being sort of quite shy, but also extroverted and kooky in the same breath, and it's so great to be able to play. So you can literally, for me, it was like being able to go out on stage and know there were all these people watching who had a preconceived idea of Draco Malfoy, and to literally be able to subvert their expectations of who they thought you were going to be. I think I will never be able to do anything like that ever again. It's such a rare thing. It was amazing.
Playing Albus is quite the opposite, I think. Because he's very much a reiteration of Harry in his sort of youth. There's lots of lines that echo things that Harry says when he's sort of going through the same sort of problems. I've been, over these last couple of months, I've read the first two books again, and sort of seeing how he, especially in the first book, sort of him finding out about how successful his parents were and stuff, and him having this weird trying to work out where he fits within the world. And I think Albus has this similar problems, and I think that's quite, although he is a new character and we haven't really seen much of him apart from that last bit within the books, that last epilogue, I think there is quite a comfort in that he seems very very much like his father in his youth, I think.
Tula, do you want to tell us, how did it feel when you got cast in Harry Potter?
When I got cast, I didn't believe it at first. So I got the recall and I was really, really nervous. And then I came back and I was like, at least I got the opportunity and stuff. And then Mum's sitting there and she was just looking at me and she said that I've got it. And I was so happy. But I didn't really shock me until I got to I went to bed and I was thinking about it. And I was, I just got a giant epiphany and I was like, I'm in Harry Potter and the Cursed Child. Oh my God.
Fantastic. Can I ask, Ryan, what is your favourite scene in Harry Potter and the Cursed Child, either that you're in or that you witness on a nightly basis?
You're going as Massive Johnny throughout the whole day. And when it gets to that last scene for everyone, it's just a big sort of sigh of relief and everything. So I think it's a good scene to just have a good think back of what what's just happened, either if you've watched two parts in the one day or watching part two over one and two over the 2 days. I think the last scene and just looking out to the audience and seeing everyone looking back at you because it's lit up at that point, so that's amazing.
Des, do you have a favourite scene to watch, because you've probably watched this play more than any of us?
Oh gosh, there's so many really, really beautiful scenes. I love Act 4. Act 4 has some really sort of exquisite writing and real stonking acting. Ginny's one of my favourite characters, and I love, there's a scene in a church with Ginny and Harry, and I think it just kind of sums up what the play is trying to say, which is that there's this thing we all need, and it's specific love, and Ginny articulates it so beautifully, and Susie and Jamie play it so beautifully that that's probably one of my favourites, of the many favourite scenes that I have in the play.
Along those lines, I think people who haven't seen the play yet, there's a lot of choreography with staircases. And there's a piece in the first play, which we call the Staircase Ballet, which again has no words in it, but some beautiful music from Imogen Heap and some amazing choreography. And that scene says so much in such a short space of time. And I'm always in the wings preparing for the next scene. And I always find it completely mesmerizing. And quite often it brings a tear to my eye. It's so beautiful. And I think that's what's so lovely about our production, is that we can do so much on stage with so little. And it's magic.
You will never see anything like it in the theater, to see such extraordinary magic, bells, whistles, fire, unbelievable illusions and effects. And then it comes down to two people talking about what it is to be human, or to be a father or a wife or a mother or a son, and just two people on stage talking. And that's what I love about these plays, is that there is just, it has everything.
I think it goes to show the heart of the show, that the for so many of us, the most special scene is predominantly just two people talking.
John, I want to ask you a question. We've had a question about how did it feel to see or hear the audience's reaction to the Dementors on your first performance?
I didn't know what the Dementors looked like. I think the rehearsal process, because you have to juggle so many balls, that I think I was just sort of tunnel vision, trying to remember everything. Hadn't seen the Dementors yet. And then we were teching, blocking it through. And Des was in the stalls and the Dementor came down into my face. And I just did a quite high pitched scream and then giggled and ran off stage. And Des was like, "You're going to do it like that?"
And he's done it like that ever since.
And yeah, I think I took the note and I ran with it. So, but no, they are astounding, and I think it is wonderful when you get an audible scream. We cherish that.
Rochelle, how do the Dementors feel for you?
I love the Dementors. They honestly, I love seeing them. The first time, we were teching, and me and Lola, one of the other swings, we watched we watched it, and it was the first time I'd seen it. So I was like, oh my gosh, we just like grabbed each other's hands and we were like visibly like, because we were just like, we're in Harry Potter. Like that, it's such a visceral moment that is just beautiful to see. It's just a gorgeous piece in the whole show. Love it.
What's really beautiful about that is that everyone has worked really hard to make you believe in the magic of the world. And even though you know is there likely to be someone in there? I'm not sure. Is there? I can't tell. And it's your brain is trying to figure it out, I think, because it is so excited by the experience of watching it. You're trying to make sense of it. And then you can't, because you can't figure it out. And it's so exciting. I'm nowhere near the stage at that point, and I always get really excited about it. Mm-hmm. So.
One of the most magnificent things about the Dementors are the actual costume itself. I mean, the material of the Dementors is something absolutely so unique and so special. There's a lot to do with time turners in the play. And if you could use a time turner in real life, when would you go to and what would you do?
Absolutely no chance. I wouldn't go near a time turner ever, ever, ever. The repercussions are too awful.
I think we're in like a time turner alternate universe right now, and
we're in the worst timeline already.
Feels like it, doesn't
2020
it?
2020 is the messed up timeline.
A nice answer would be I would use a time turner and I would go forward to when we can all be back together at work together again.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, yeah.
A huge thank you to my fellow cast members for helping to give a little peek at what goes on behind the stage curtain. This isn't our usual setup, but we hope we've given you a glimpse into the enchanting world of Harry Potter and the Cursed Child. And we hope to be back at the Palace Theatre in London just as soon as we can. Now, let's see if I can remember this final trick. Perfect.